Hi, everybody. Okay, I'm going to read chapter 3 of Agua Sangre. I haven't had a chance. So, do it now before I go to sleep. Okay, here we go. Okay, here we go. Chapter 3. This is Agua Sangre, blood water. Right now. I could press a button and have more dollars than I ever imagined I would. And I have to say, I'm surprised that it makes me a little nauseous. I'm unsure who to tell and what to do. I've always made enough money to do whatever I wanted to do, but I don't spend a lot of money because I've never needed much. I feel like a lottery winner, and the stories you hear about lottery winners never seem to end happily. I'm 44 years old. I'm not married, no kids that I know of. I travel a lot whenever I can because I want to experience as much as I can while I can. Life is the great unknown, and life is what happens while you're making other plans. So I focus on today and make today the most important time. It doesn't mean I don't worry about things, but it is a work in progress and everything is relative. Let's just say I focus on being better than I used to be. I use the Serenity Prayer to provide strength and peace of mind in my quest to formulate guidance and make good decisions. Lord, please grant me the serenity to accept those things I cannot change, the courage to change those things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. Most days I try to walk and move for at least a few hours every day, eat good food, practice my music, pray for those I love, and remember to be grateful for each and every day. Call it religion or spirituality, to each their own. We all need someone to emulate. It is important for me to remember that the stay in this world is but a moment in time, 100 years or less for most of us. Some believe this is all there is. We are here today and gone tomorrow. Then, dirt nap. I don't believe that. I believe it is a mistake to ignore that we will all be dead a lot longer than we are alive. And how we choose to live this life probably has an impact on where we go next. Free will, free choice. We are free to choose, and we will all find out one day who chose wisely and who chose poorly. I was pondering all of this as I walked on the beach and then drank my coffee in my attempt to decide what action to take. As I was thinking this thought, as if it nudged him out of bed, I heard Levon rise and go to the bathroom before walking down the stairs to the patio a few minutes later with his hunting dog, Rosie, following behind him. Rosie is an incredible specimen that looks like she was chiseled out of granite. She is white with brown spots in the shape of kidney beans. I suspect she is part pit bull and part boxer, but Levon calls her his hunting dog. She is one of these rare creatures that would do anything she was ordered to do by her master without hesitation, but was also very good-natured. She was happy and loving to most people who wanted her kisses. Levon has an older dog named Pancha that is very envious of Rosie, but she would probably run and hide at the first sign of any trouble. Good morning, Dawe. Now, Levon is German and speaks 8 languages, but he was nice enough to use English. My Spanish is good enough to handle buenos dias. Heck, even my German, which is zilch, can handle guten morgen. But like I said, great guy. Thankfully, he didn't use Russian or Goonie Goo Goo. That's a joke, by the way. Hey, Levon, guten Morgen. It is a beautiful morning. I saw the whales on patrol again this morning. Ah, really? Wonderful, man. When Levon speaks English, it is probably a mix of all the cadences from the various languages he knows. But I sometimes will chuckle when he speaks, because if I closed my eyes, he could be a Jamaican saying, "Hey, man," in their rhythmic tone. I'd open my eyes expecting dreadlocks or Bob Marley, and I would see this sinewy guy a year older than me with his auburn hair and more of an orange beard and mustache. His hair is always up, but when he lets it down, he reminds me of Jesus Christ. Levon was born in 1972. His father was driving his wife to the hospital to have their child, and Elton John came on the radio. And he shall be Levon, and he shall be a good man, and he shall be Levon, in tradition with the family plan. Woo! And so when he was born, and his father was told, congratulations, you have a son, he cried out, he shall be Levon, and he shall be a good man. Not a popular name in Germany, but his dad didn't care. Levon might have as much fat on his whole body that I have on my right foot. So in this hot and humid climate, he has no worries or concerns walking around half naked. He drinks a large glass of water and then grabs some coffee and settles down in a hammock about 2 meters away from me. Rosie comes over and nudges me with a ginormous head, which is her way of telling me, you may pet me now, plebe, which I do. I've known Levon for several years. I met him when I came walking down the beach and approached his house to see who lived there. Don't laugh, but the universe will tell us where to go and what to do if we listen. It sends us messages and signals all the time, but we are usually caught up in our own issues and don't notice them. Well, thankfully, I listened that day. I don't remember the exact date or even the year now without looking it up. It was my first time in Puerto Escondido. And at the urging of a woman in the local tourism office, I took a 45-minute ride on a colectivo from Puerto Escondido to La Iglesia Amarilla, the Yellow Church in Escobilla, to see the giant turtles lay their eggs. I arrived early. We were told it would be several hours before we were allowed onto the beach to see the turtles. I asked the coordinator if there was a place on a beach nearby where I could grab something to eat and a beer. He smiled and replied in rapid fire Spanish that was too fast for me to understand. I smiled back and said, muchas gracias. Mi español es muy mal. Por favor, habla despacio. Asking him to tell me again, this time more slowly. This time, I understood that he wanted me to go out to the main road, the federal highway, wave down a colectivo that would take me back in the direction I came from to a place called Agua Blanca, disembark there, walk down a long road to the beach. There was another foreigner already there, around my age, who had arrived early as well. He spoke no English. He was an Italian guy who had no problem with Spanish. He heard what the man had told me and asked if he could tag along. Sure, why not? So we had to communicate in Spanish. I was happy to have the company and off we went. A colectivo is usually some sort of bus, long or short, but can also be a taxi that is going someplace and wants to fill the car that travels between two destinations and will stop to pick up people along the way. They might stop to pick up and drop off people dozens of times, or might only stop once or twice. It is quite random, depending on the route, the time of the day, et al. After a brief wait, we spotted the bus approaching, and we waved our arms to hail it and climbed aboard when it stopped. The directions the guy gave us were adequate. The Italian was more proficient in Spanish than me, so he told the driver of the colectivo where we were going, and the driver of the bus knew exactly where to stop and signaled to us when we had arrived. We paid the driver as we exited and crossed the road to make the walk down to the beach. The sun was so strong. I would not be surprised if it was 100 degrees Fahrenheit. And the walk down that dirt road to the beach felt like it would never end. We finally arrived and the beach was lined with dozens of huts and palapa roofs extending out into the sand. It was so much more than what I expected. Apparently, these were all different restaurants stacked one after the next. Every restaurant looked similar. So we walked to the water, and turned to search for the nicest spot on the beach and settled down in a chair under a palapa roof that belonged to one of the several makeshift restaurants on the sand near that spot. We were greeted by a young girl who asked us what we wanted to drink, and we both ordered an ice cold beer. When she brought the beers, we then ordered the local fish that was caught earlier in the day. They fried them up and served with whatever garnishings they had on hand. It didn't make any difference to me. I was happy to be on this beautiful beach in the shade with a cold beer in my hand. My new friend and I clanged beers as we both said salute simultaneously. We were all smiles. This must be paradise. The Italian guy was short, completely bald, and thin, except for a round tummy, which I only noticed when, after ordering our food, he unexpectedly stripped down his shorts to his shorts and ran screaming to the water and dove into the surf. He had the look of joy on his face that a child has on Christmas Day. How could I resist that? I stripped down to my boxes and ran to the water with our clothes in my hands, which I tossed onto the sand before jumping into the waves. The water was shockingly refreshing on such a hot day, and the power of the waves made it difficult to stand up and stay on your feet. I couldn't stop laughing as the waves tossed me around like I was on the agitation cycle in a washing machine. After a few minutes, he managed to exit the surf and spent the next few minutes covering his head and body with suntan lotion. I stayed in the water until the food arrived, which came much faster than I expected. After we ate, we both felt like kings, proud of our decision to make this excursion in lieu of wasting several hours sitting on the floor in waiting. After eating, he decided to go back into the water. But my curious nature pushed me to go out and recon and explore this village on the mighty Pacific, one of probably hundreds of villages in Mexico along its lengthy coastline. I walked along the beach between the ocean and the restaurants. As I walked away from the main beach area with the restaurants, I noticed a single house in the distance all by itself, reminding me of Mont Saint-Michel in Normandy, France. Was this house also surrounded by the ocean at high tide? I went to find out. When I arrived, there were a few people on the patio of the house. I said hello and asked if the owner of the house was there. He came out of his hammock to greet me, and this is the first time I met Levon. I felt an instant connection to this little village and wanted to stay there for a few days, but alas, it was not meant to be. Sorry, man. I will have a spare room you can rent after the holidays. Well, I already had plans that took me elsewhere, but I vowed to go back, and I kept that promise a few months later when I returned to stay at his house for the first time. Sometimes you meet people and you like them immediately, and this is what I thought of Levon. This is how I met Levon, and I have returned to stay with him at least once every year since, sometimes for several months at a time. So back to the present, on the patio on this beautiful morning, which is the norm here. Rosie is in heaven as I rub the back of her ears and knead her neck. I stop periodically, and she prods me with her snout to continue, and I massage her hips next, and she drops to the ground and shows her belly with her paws extended up to the sky. Really, Rosie? I ask her. She sneezes and her head moves up and down as if to say yes. Are you going to buy some land here, man? Levon asks. He knows how most foreigners think. Most cannot be satisfied with enjoying this place and leaving it the way they found it. Most have to conquer and plant their flag. Then eventually it is transformed into what they were originally running away from. I too have been indoctrinated to think that way. And over the years, Levon and I have discussed various ideas of buying property and creating communities and businesses. I love it when I'm here, Levon, but I don't want to be here year round. I don't have unlimited money and I'm a gringo. You know what I mean? I could buy land here or in one of several places I enjoyed. But I never saw the point of tying up money into something that was only being used occasionally or was not generating income. I did not want the complexity of ownership in a foreign land and getting around the restrictions of owning land near the coast. where I am not a citizen. Most foreigners who own land in Mexico will say there is no risk, and they're right if everything goes well, but it is foolish to ignore the fact that you have no rights in Mexico when the shite hits the fan. The local indigenous people could come and take it all back at some point, and you would be left with nothing. For those speculating, the risk is less when you buy extremely low and sell higher. But when I make these decisions, I have to factor in this additional risk. Yes, waterfront land on the Pacific here is cheaper than in the USA, but the additional risk has to be factored into a discounted price. Most people never consider this worst case scenario and are not prepared when it happens. They only see how cheap it is in comparison to where they come from, never asking themselves what the odds are of walking away with nothing. Levon knows how I feel about this. He has been here for a dozen years, and he has faced the discrimination that comes with being a foreigner in Mexico. There are many advantages to being an expat when you can pick up and move like the wind. However, investing your capital into a foreign country that does not have concrete contract and property laws and systems introduces additional risk and may require greasing palms, a slippery slope that may never end. I know the future is bright here, Levon, but is it a mistake to assume prices will always rise or that you will find some greater fool to sell to when ready to do so? If Bill Gates lost 50 to 100K, that is the equivalent of me losing a nickel or a dime. But for me, losing that much money would hurt. Most people in the USA consider real estate to be risk-free, but I've never been a fan of owning a single-family home, especially when considering you never really own the property. In the USA, imagine paying off your mortgage and then still paying rent, taxes, for the right to stay in the home you paid off. If it generated income, I might be less pessimistic. There is a lot of potential here, Dawei. Land prices are rising. The infrastructure in Oaxaca is improving, meaning more people will be coming here in the future. I know, Levon. I just don't want to be forced to be here all year long. It's not that bad. I'm not saying it's bad, but when I really enjoy being someplace and think of buying property, I consider two things. Number one, how long do I want to stay here? If I only want to be there a month or two every year, maybe it is best to rent. When I move on, I have no worries or concerns. I used to winter in Florida and California and in various places in Asia. I liked them all, but there is always someplace else you can go. I may pay a premium when I rent, but I also don't have the risk and headache of ownership, which I might entertain if I was there longer, especially if it was bought inexpensively and/or generated income. I ran the numbers in these places and found that it is much more advantageous for me to rent, even for 3 to 6 months at a time. Number two, as an example, when I see a piece of artwork I really like, I will not buy it after a first viewing. I have found that my opinion of it changes with time and exposure. I need to see it several times to make sure it is what I want. The same is true for most big ticket items I purchase. It has taken me years, but I have made great strides towards pushing past my indoctrinations and visceral reactions to weigh the potential risks that could impact decisions. When we are younger, our hormones are quite powerful and can lead us to do things that we would probably not have done if we had taken the time to ponder under further examination. In addition, it gets hot here in Agua Blanca, really hot. So hot, I feel like I am melting. Staying with you is a lot simpler than building and maintaining my own house. You never know what you're going to find in Mexico. You can buy land and wait and see. Yes, indeed. That might be the best option. But if you weren't here, who would I have here who I could trust to look after things while I was gone? He didn't have an answer, but it is a real concern in Mexico. People can squat on your property, and Mexican law allows the squatter to take possession of your property. Possession is 9/10 of the law, as they say. So absentee property owners hire people to stay in their house or guard their land while they are away. Levon worked for a large German multinational corporation after leaving the military. He came to Mexico on holiday and never returned to Germany to live full time again. He knew after one day in Agua Blanca that he had found his home. He ended up staying on the beach all night with his friends. The light from the moon illuminated the beach and made the crest of the waves glow, a magical experience that served to be his calling. Agua Blanca's magic hit him the same way it hit me, but Levon spent many years in Africa in the French Foreign Legion, so he doesn't mind the heat and humidity. I'm from New Hampshire, and I don't think I would ever enjoy the intensity of this heat. In addition, only the USA and Eritrea required citizens to pay their pound of flesh even after they no longer reside there. So becoming a full-time expat is that much more beneficial for people from every other country. They no longer have to file taxes with their home country or be concerned about paying a pound of flesh to a government. Many of the foreigners I meet in Mexico ran away from the countries of their birth. It is amazing to meet so many people from around the world who share similar experiences and points of view. It seems that no matter which country you go to, the biggest criminals in the world are drawn into the government because they realize they can utilize the police, military, and unlimited government resources to achieve their objectives, as well as eliminate competition. I have paid so much in taxes over the years. It pains me to think of all those hours wasted to earn the money needed to pay those taxes, to avoid having armed men come and take me away and put me in a cage, forcing me to fight losing battles in court. I abhor paying taxes because I do not want to support the evil that controls most governments. Think of the good that could be done if that power was removed from government, especially from a central government. Most people choose to put their head in the sand and ignore it. They claim to stand for rule of law, which means all people are equal in the eyes of the law. We know that isn't true. It pained me to see all the violence the U.S. government initiated around the world. Mindless fools would cheer on and thank the troops for killing these brown people who were defending their homelands, never questioning why their troops were really there. It is not by accident that U.S. schools do not teach students about people like Smedley Butler. Butler was the most decorated U.S. Marine at the time, awarded 2 Congressional Medal of Honor. He was so frustrated with his time in the Corps, he came to the conclusion that he was just a henchman for big corporations. The U.S. Marines were repeatedly sent to foreign countries to beat down locals who had the audacity to stand up to these corporations. In his book, War is a Racket, he explains what was true then and is still true today. Does anyone question how politicians leave their offices multiple times richer than when they entered? These people leave these government positions with millions in savings and investments. Nobody seems to notice. Nobody seems to care. It doesn't change because no one wants it to change. People are complicit in these crimes, and it is why I leave the USA as frequently as I do. Remember the scene from Top Gun when Charlie, played by Kelly McGillis, is reviewing and rating the pilot's recent training dogfights? She singles out Maverick, played by Tom Cruise, who won his duel and chastises him for his decision to engage in a dogfight. After Maverick defends his actions, she ends up by saying, "Well, that's a big gamble with a $30 million plane, Lieutenant," then addressing the entire class. Unfortunately, the gamble worked. The encounter was a victory, but I think we've shown it as an example of what not to do. The commander then commented it was best not to push a bad position, to retire and fight another day. In a video game, I suppose it doesn't matter, but in life, you may not get a second chance, especially if it costs you your life. My name is not David Martyr. I prefer to avoid fighting losing battles, so I vote with my feet. But the world is approaching a tipping point when we will have no other choice but to resist and demand change. But until that day arrives, I will focus on surviving and thriving and being prepared when the time comes. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. John 3, verse 16. That is the end of chapter 3 of Agua Sangre. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, comments, leave them. And I'll take a look. Have a great night, everybody. Peace. He shall believe on.
He shall shall believe on.